anyone seen my sermon anywhere?
That is a live recorded photo.
Hey, his sermon wasn't in that one.
I don't know, there's some pack of papers here.
Check 1, 2.
Thank you.
morning, church, and welcome in the name of our risen Lord Jesus Christ. I'm Pastor Sean, and we're glad to be gathered here with you this day. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
You may be seated. Would the children please come forward? You know what we have to talk about today? We got to talk about what it means to be on a team. What does it mean to be on a team? Kelly says it means about being ducks. Quack, quack. Is that like Mighty Ducks? Yeah, I know. We all love the Mighty Ducks. What did you say before, Perry?
I said winning.
Perry said winning. Yes, being on a team is sometimes about winning. But is that the most important part about being on a team?
No.
Oh, what did you say, Quinny?
Teamwork.
Yes,
fireworks.
Teamwork. That's right.
Fireworks.
You know, the important...
Fireworks,
yes, thank you, bud. Yes, teamwork is the most important part about being on a team. Being on a team means that you're not just out there all by yourself, but that you have teammates, that you have people around you. In this morning's reading, can you wait 1 second and then tell me? All right, what is it? Go ahead.
Also cheering.
Also cheering, yes. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm glad you stopped me for that. Hey, let go of her for a second. Cheering is an important part of being on a team because you want to root your team on. But in our Romans reading today, Paul explains that being a church is a lot like being on a team. What do you think he meant by that? Do you think he meant that the most important part is winning?
Yep.
No. Oh, my goodness, Quinn. You couldn't be further from the truth. No, what Paul means... You know what? I'm on a team. Did you know that? Can you guys listen? I'm on a team. Yeah, this is my team. Look at these guys. And guess what? We don't win at anything. But that doesn't mean we're not a team. We're a team because we work and play together. And if all of us came here and played electric guitar like Mr. Bly, would that be a good band? No. If all of us came and played drums like Timmy, would that be a good band? If all of us came and played piano like Mr. Blackwell, would that be a good band?
No.
No, we all need different things, and that's what it's like being a part of the church. God has given each of us very different gifts, and when we come together, we use them for God's work. We're going to sing a song about that in just 1 second, but let's say a prayer about it right now. Please fold your hands.
What?
Okay, let's pray, and then you can tell me. Dear God, thank you for making us a part of the most important team of all, your team, a team that's not about winning, but about what we can accomplish when we use our different gifts and work together. We love you. Amen.
I remember that Kelly had drums.
Thank you.
O God, be with all your faithful followers of every age. We praise you. You are the rock of our life. Be our strong foundation and form us into the body of your Son, that we may gladly minister to all the world as your team, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated for the readings.
Our first reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 51, verses 1 through 6. Just as God had called Abraham and Sarah and given them many descendants, so now God offers comfort to Zion. God's deliverance will come soon and will never end. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many. For the Lord will comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places and will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Listen to me, my people, and give heed to me, my nation, for a teaching will go out from me and my justice for a light to the peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and for my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath, for the heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. In response to God's merciful activity, we are to worship by living holistic, God-pleasing lives. Our values and viewpoints are not molded by the time in which we live, but are transformed by the Spirit's renewing work. God's grace empowers different forms of service among Christians, but all forms of ministry function to build up the body of Christ. A reading from St. Paul. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel this morning comes from St. Matthew, the 16th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Well, some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly orders the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. About 5 years ago, Carol and I traded in our 1915 house for a 2015 house. And while we like our new digs because it comes with sheetrocked walls and 16-inch on-center studs and more insulation than we could have fathomed in our old house, there are some things that 1915 houses offer that 2015 houses just can't. And that's character and an altogether different type of craftsmanship. One of the things that I was astonished about when we moved into our 1915 house was the look of that old stone foundation. Unlike today's form and pour types of foundations or cinder block installations, the foundation of our first house was all rough, random, rough cut stones. Big, old, each placed on top of each other with precision, creating a foundation which, with a little bit of maintenance over time, would end up lasting 100 years and hopefully 100 more. In fact, while we were living in that old house, we ourselves had the foundation repointed, not only because it made the house look a little bit nicer and kept the chipmunks from storing all of their winter booty in our basement, but more importantly, because we knew how important that big foundation, those rocks, were. It doesn't matter how well you build what's on top when the foundation isn't up to the task. In this morning's gospel reading, Jesus talks about a foundation of an altogether different sort. Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people think I am?" And they tell him what they've heard, and the answer is pretty much, they think you're anybody. You could be Elijah, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But then he asks, "Who do you think that I am?" And Peter boldly exclaims, "You are the Messiah. You're the Son of the living God." And Peter must still have been a little new to the whole Jesus thing. Otherwise, he would have known that opening your mouth in a church setting is dangerous. It almost certainly means that you're going to be signed up for something, and that was the truth with Jesus. He was. Peter says, "You are the Christ," and Jesus responds, "You are the rock. You are the rock upon which I will build my church." A metaphor frequently used for the church is that it's like a house. And what does every house need but a foundation? And in this morning's text, Jesus says that Peter is that foundation. But if I could be honest, if I could get just 1 second with Jesus, I might ask him if he wanted to maybe pick a different foundation other than Peter. Or if he's going to pick Peter, at least he could do is get Peter repointed or do a little maintenance on him before he gives him the keys. I mean, Peter, the guy who we heard just a couple of weeks ago didn't have the faith to walk to Jesus on the water, who Jesus had to say, "Why did you doubt?" That doubting guy, or the same denying guy who, as Jesus is pouring out his life on the cross, manages to deny Jesus not once or twice, but 3 different times, or the same Peter who just next week we are going to hear as Jesus talks about what his mission is in the church, Peter decides he knows better to the point where Jesus himself has to turn and say to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." That Peter? Are you sure, Jesus? Are you sure that's the guy that you want to build your church on? The guy who didn't have enough faith? The guy who was more concerned with his hide than with his friends? The guy who even moments after having the clarity and the faithfulness to say, "You're the Christ," followed it up by demonstrating that he really didn't get it at all? That's the guy? Well, yeah. That's the guy. That's the guy that God chooses to use. And look. Just look at the church. Look at what that church, who Jesus handed over to his disciples and the rock, Peter, has done. And I'm not talking about, look at like the big, beautiful cathedrals that tourists walk through today. But I'm instead saying, look at what the church has done for orphans and widows in a time before foster homes and Medicare. Look at what the church has done in a world without hospitals, but instead offering up its own sense of Christian hospitality to those who are in need of being healed. Look at the mouths that have been fed by that church, by the bodies that have been clothed in love for our brothers and sisters. Think about the millions pulled from the dreadful grip of depression and anxiety because that church shared a word about love and hope. Imagine the multitudes that have found life because of the church that Jesus handed over to Peter. What the church has done in the last 2,000 years is unreal, but it's especially unreal when you consider who Jesus named as the rock of the whole operation. But that's how God works. God doesn't use perfect people, and God never has. The foundation of our new building here at church actually reminded me of that. It was not long after our mason laid the block foundation for the interior of the wall of the gymnasium that I, operating a forklift, managed to go over to pick up a stack of bricks nearby, only instead to slam right into that foundation and crumble it to the ground. While feeling some combination of remorse and frustration, I was reminded by the other people on the project that day that there would be mistakes because none of us are perfect. We would fix it, but likely, just after we fixed it, we would mess something else up instead. And guess what? We did. And we have. But as we gather this day for our 5th annual Hope for a Future golf tournament, I'm excited to announce that we're just weeks away from a partial opening of that building. And it's amazing to me as I look at what we've accomplished, because then I look at in the mirror and I see some of the people who have put the time into it, as imperfect as we are. God has used us to do something amazing together. So this text, it's not just about God putting Peter in charge. It's about you and it's about me. Peter may be the rock, but God's got a plan for us too. God has a purpose for each of us, and he doesn't wait for us to open up our mouths on accident so we get signed up like the church does. God just calls. And when God calls, we answer. Usually we find an excuse first. Maybe like Peter, we feel like we don't have enough faith. Maybe we think we don't have enough time. We feel like we're not churchy enough to do that. Maybe you feel like you don't have the talents or the gifts. We have our excuses, and some of them may even be true, but God isn't calling us to follow him because of our resume or our accolades. God isn't calling us to work for him because of how perfect we are, but instead, exactly the opposite, because that's what God does, and that's who God uses. And so this day, when we see Jesus handing over the work of the church to his disciples, we're reminded that Jesus hands that same work of the church over to us. Imperfect or not, God has a plan and a purpose for you.
I can be healed, 'cause I'm so calloused, and now I can't feel. I wanna run to you with heart wide open. Make me broken. Make me empty, so I can be. I can be yours. Till I want no one more than you, Lord. 'Cause in the darkness I know you will hold me. Make me lonely.
Together in trust and in hope, we profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and he was born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We kneel or remain standing for the prayers of the people.
Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Lord, our rock, you are our foundation in Jesus Christ, your Son, whom we confess as the living God. Prepare your church for its mission in bearing witness to Christ, both here at home and throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You call forth praises from the far reaches of the universe to the smallest of creatures. Join our songs to theirs, that a spirit of praise and thanksgiving will arouse us to cherish this wondrous home you give us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord. Direct the leaders of countries, legislators and magistrates, mayors and councils, to walk in your ways. Help leaders regard those in need with mercy and fulfill your loving purposes in the governance of peoples. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Though we walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve us, deliver us, and fulfill your purpose for us. According to your steadfast love, grant healing and wholeness to those who are bereaved, in trouble or in adversity, or sick and in need of care, especially Mary, Dave, Catherine, Ed, Sandy, Rick, Lloyd, Randy, Suzanne, Jane, Corey, Jeremiah, Serena, Aaron, Andy, Barb, Jerry, Kim, Ellen, Jack, Emily, Joseph, Ken, Wesley, Greg, Terry, Darlene, Gail, Joey, Laura, and Carly. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You call us into this community in which we, though many, are one in Christ. May we recognize in ourselves and in one another the unique gifts you have given us for the building up of the church for the sake of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You are the everlasting rock from which we were hewn, and you restore your people to joy and gladness. In blessed memory and hope, we thank you for the lives of our beloved dead. Bring us with them to our heavenly home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. It is now time for the offering to be received. Those of you who would like to make a contribution out of what God has given you to God's mission through hope are welcome to do so by following the link and directions on the screen or giving right here on our Facebook page. While we offer up our gifts to God, we also up our voices using the song, The Well.
Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. I have what you need, but you keep on searching. I've done all the work, but you keep on working. When you're running on empty and you can't find the remedy, just come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more. And all who search will find what their soul.
Come to the well.
God of goodness, God of growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us, that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song. Amen. Please receive this blessing. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, bless us and keep us in eternal love. Amen.
I believe I overcome.
Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.